Welcome home, children. We need to hear those words. A great day is coming. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that with us. How many of you today believe that Jesus Christ is coming soon? How many? Now, I am glad I can see that in a Seventh-day Adventist church. I wouldn't want to see anything else. But now let me ask another question. Think back. Some of you who have been Seventh-day Adventists for a number of years, think back to about 1950, in a camp meeting somewhere, in a convocation. Did a speaker ask you that very same question? And what was your response as you listened to that question at that time? Did you raise your hand? You did. I know you did. You said that Jesus is coming soon. Now let's go farther back. Some of us have had parents who grew up as Seventh-day Adventists. And back around 1910, a camp meeting speaker might have asked that same question. What do you think the response would have been? The same thing? Absolutely. What about around the years 1888 and 1889 and 1890? Would the response have been identical? It would. What about in 1844? Wouldn't the response have been overwhelming in 1844 to that question? Then that leaves us with a dilemma. Hasn't something gone tragically wrong in the expectation of Seventh-day Adventists? Could it be possible that our sons and our grandsons could be asking that same question 50 years down the line? What is to prevent that from happening? What guarantee do we have that that will not be the case? Would I shock too many people this morning if I said that we have no guarantees that Jesus is coming soon at all? For that is exactly the conclusion I have come to during the last few years of my study. I do not believe that we can say unequivocally that Jesus will come within the next 10 or even 20 years. Now, before someone rises to escort me from the pulpit of a Seventh-day Adventist church for saying that, let me tell you exactly what I do believe, and I want you to turn in the Bible with me to Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. Beginning right at the first verse, please. And after these things I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, "Hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads." These four angels have been holding the winds of destruction for a long time now, haven't they? They have been holding. They have been specifically ordered to keep holding those winds until God's final sealing work could be finished. Now that tells us two things. First, the sealing work is not yet finished, is it? Second, we will not see an end to this world's suffering and misery until the sealing work is finished. That's the second point. Even if that should be decades in the future. Do you see why I said that we have no guarantee that Jesus' coming will be soon? But now, having said that we have no guarantee, may I hasten to add that I believe that the coming of Jesus could be very, very soon. It seems that there are certain periods when God moves events in human history to climax points. And then he waits to see if his people are ready to move with him. In 1844, he worked mightily through the Millerite movement with great power. And if his people would have hung together in faith and courage, the work could have been finished very soon after that period, after the great disappointment. The sealing work could have been finished, and God's people could have gone home with him. And then things went into a sort of plateau. And that plateau lasted for about 40 years. And at the period of 1888 to 1893, God began moving things again toward a climax point in history. And once again, God watched hopefully to see if his people would catch the vision that he had for them and get serious about going home this time. But once again, God's desires were thwarted, this time by selfish, fault-finding, power-seeking Seventh-day Adventist men and women. And so we went into another plateau. You know how long this plateau has lasted? Over 90 years we have been in a plateau. It is my considered judgment that we are moving toward another of those rare climax points in human history. When God is moving events once again into a final countdown, and once again, he is hoping that his people will catch the vision of eternity and join with him in bringing an end to the sin problem on this earth. Will they do it this time? But no, that's not the question. The question is, will we do it this time? If we decide that we are ready to get serious about our chosen name, Seventh-day Adventist, then this whole thing could be over in just a very short time. On the other hand, if we just keep sleeping along and congratulating ourselves about our beautiful churches and our fine organs and the surging numbers of baptisms in parts of the world other than North America, then this climax point will pass just like all the others did. And this tired old world will go on struggling for survival. And you and I will go to our graves in disappointment. Now let me share a personal fear with you, one that I cannot prove, but a fear that haunts me at times. Because I love this church and I love this message very much. This just may be the last opportunity for the Seventh-day Adventist Church to get its act together and fulfill its mission as God's chosen people. I am fearful that if we fail again, that the negative trends now at work within our church may make it totally impossible for God to bring this church to yet another climax point in history. And he may be forced to give his vineyard to other husbandmen. Now you are certainly wondering if my reading of the spirit of prophecy has been so meager that I have never seen the statements that the church will go through. Beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, I have read and treasured those statements. I have held on to them when things seemed to be falling apart. But I have also read some other statements in those same writings that say something else. First, though, back in the time of Christ, the Jews had some treasured statements that they used to encourage themselves when things looked dark in their own perspective. And I want to go back now to a text that they treasured. It's in the book of Jeremiah. Join me there, please. Jeremiah chapter 31. We'll begin reading at verse 35. Jeremiah 31, verse 35. Thus saith the Lord, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinances of the moon and of the stars for a light by night, which divideth the sea when the waves thereof roar, the Lord of hosts is his name. If those ordinances depart from before me, saith the Lord, then the seed of Israel also shall cease from being a nation before me forever. Thus saith the Lord, if heaven above can be measured, and the foundations of the earth searched out beneath, I will also cast off all the seed of Israel for all that they have done, saith the Lord. Look at the very last phrase in verse 40. It shall not be plucked up nor thrown down any more forever. God told the Jews that as long as the sun and the moon and the stars remained in the sky, they would be his chosen people. His promise was that just as surely as no one could measure the heavens or the depths of the earth, he would never cast off Israel as his chosen people. Ellen White comments on this passage. These words the Jews applied to themselves. And because God had shown them so great favor and mercy, they flattered themselves that notwithstanding their sins and iniquity, notice, notwithstanding their sins and iniquity, he would still retain them as his favored people and shower special blessings upon them. This has been the danger of the people of God in all ages, and especially is this the danger of those living near the close of time. If they shut their eyes, as did the Jews, to their own corruption and choose their own ways, the Lord will give them up to the blindness of mind and hardness of heart, that they cannot discern the things of the Spirit of God. But now go back. Doesn't that promise that we just read sound absolute, the one in Jeremiah? Weren't the Jews justified in believing that Israel would stand forever as God's chosen people? Are we not likewise justified in believing that our ship will go through when we read that though it appears to fall, it will not fall? Or have they and we both forgotten another crucially important principle in the Bible, in the same book, in fact? Go back to the 18th chapter of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 18, verses 9 and 10. And at what instant I shall speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom, to build and to plant it, if it do evil in my sight, that it obey not my voice, then I will repent of the good wherewith I said I would benefit them. Any promise God ever makes to an individual or to a church concerning their relationship to him and their future is always conditional upon obedience. Always. Go way back now to the book of Deuteronomy, please. The 28th chapter of Deuteronomy. Back when Moses was just finishing his ministry, ending a lifetime of leading the chosen people out, he left this on record for all future time. Deuteronomy chapter 28. We'll read just some selected verses. Let's begin with verse 1. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Verse 9. The Lord shall establish thee an holy people unto himself, as he hath sworn unto thee, if thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in all his ways. Verse 13. And the Lord shall make thee the head, and not the tail, and thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath, if that thou hearken unto the commandments of the Lord thy God, which I command thee this day, to observe and to do them. But now verse 15. And it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee, and overtake thee. Verse 20, the Lord shall send upon thee cursing, vexation, and rebuke in all that thou settest thine hand unto for to do, until thou be destroyed, and until thou perish quickly, because of the wickedness of thy doings, whereby thou hast forsaken me. Verse 45, moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee, and shall pursue thee, and overtake thee, till thou be destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes which he commanded thee. Ellen White puts it very succinctly. It should be remembered that the promises and the threatenings of God are alike conditional. Evangelism, page 695. Do you know that we are in danger of forgetting this principle just as were the Jews in Christ's time? May I share with you now a few of those, quote, other inspired statements that are not heard very often in Seventh-day Adventist churches or Seventh-day Adventist publications. I'll give you the reference for each one. Testimonies, volume 5, page 217. I am filled with sadness when I think of our condition as a people. Our own course of continual backsliding has separated us from God, and yet the general opinion is that the church is flourishing and that peace and spiritual prosperity are in all her borders. The church has turned back from following Christ, her leader, and is steadily retreating toward Egypt. Testimonies to Ministers, page 397. The whole body is sick because of mismanagement and miscalculation. Review and Herald, July 24, 1888. Some power has cut the cable, and we are drifting away to sea without chart or compass. Testimonies, volume 5, 75 and 76. You are following the same path as did ancient Israel. Your neglect to follow the light will place you in a more unfavorable position than the Jews upon whom Christ pronounced a woe. Testimonies, volume 8, page 250. Unless the church, which is now being leavened with her own backsliding, shall repent and be converted, she will eat of the fruit of her own doing until she shall abhor herself. Testimonies, volume 5, page 71. It pains me to say, my brethren, that your sinful neglect to walk in the light has enshrouded you in darkness. You may now be honest in not recognizing and obeying the light. The doubt you have entertained, your neglect to heed the requirements of God, have blinded your perceptions, so that darkness is now to you light, and light is darkness. In a letter to Butler and Haskell on December 8, 1886, oh, what privileges are granted to us as a people. And if God spared not his people that he loved because they refused to walk in the light, how can he spare the people whom he has blessed with the light of heaven in having opened to them the most exalted truth ever entrusted to mortal man to give to the world? Internal corruption will bring the denunciations of God upon this people as it did upon Jerusalem. My brethren, we know not what is before us. God will work with us and for us if the sins which brought his wrath upon the old world, upon Sodom and Gomorrah, and upon ancient Jerusalem do not become our crime. In Review and Herald, Volume 2, page 308, what would the Savior do if he should come to us now as he did to the Jews? He would have to do a similar work. Testimonies, Volume 8, pages 67 and 68. Jerusalem is a representation of what the church will be if it refuses to receive and walk in the light that God has given. These are no idle tales, but truth. Testimonies, Volume 1, 608 and 609. If we imitate their example of transgression, Israel's example, and depart from God, we shall fall as surely as did they. Testimonies, Volume 8, page 127. Let a church become proud and boastful, not depending on God, not exalting His power, and that church will surely be left by the Lord, to be brought down to the ground. Let a people glory in wealth, intellect, knowledge, or in anything but Christ, and they will soon be brought to confusion. Do you see now why I made the strong statement that I did about this possibly being our last opportunity to be used by God to finish His work? Yes, I also believe that the ship will go through, but brothers and sisters, the ship is you and me. It is not some entity outside of us which will carry us through if we just hang on to it. The ship of Adventism will go through if you and I dedicate our entire energies to learning and living God's will for this crisis time. In other words, it is our decision that will determine what happens to this church. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I am not suggesting at all that we can best do God's will by separating ourselves from this church. In fact, I am afraid that if all God's faithful ones would separate themselves from the church, then the church surely would be doomed to destruction, and we might indeed miss this magnificent opportunity we have to usher in the second coming quickly, and we might face the unpleasant prospect of going to our graves in disappointment and grief. What I am saying is that we dare not be too complacent in our belief that the church is going through automatically, and we will make it too if we just hang on. No, fellow believers, hanging on is not good enough, not today. Our only hope lies in study and prayer such as none of us have ever done before in our lives. If what I am saying is at all true, then how can we be sure that we will not make the mistakes of the Jews and lose our position as God's remnant people? How can we go through ourselves and make it possible for Jesus to come and end this planet's suffering and its pain? May I suggest that we are never so blind as when we ignore our past and when we assume that past failures can never be our failures. We have had a dramatic demonstration of God's will and purpose and man's ability to thwart that will right within our church. May I suggest that if we have the slightest chance to be God's remnant today, we must understand as completely as humanly possible what happened between 1888 and 1900. That was our last opportunity to go home. And we must know why it did not happen back then, or we will go through the same mistakes again. If you don't know much about that period, may I urge you, not suggest, urge you not to delay one more day to make that subject the top priority on your list of study and prayer. What is the divine analysis of this message, the 1888 message? Testimonies to Ministers, page 91. The Lord, in His great mercy, sent a most precious message to His people through Elders Wagoner and Jones. Manuscript 15, 1888. This message, understood in its true character and proclaimed in the Spirit, will lighten the earth with its glory. Now that is the language of the loud cry of the third angel's message, isn't it? Thus, we can conclude, I think, very honestly that God was intending to prepare His people and give the final message through the 1888 message. But what happened? Selected Messages, Volume 1, page 234 and 235. By exciting that opposition, Satan succeeded in shutting away from our people, in a great measure, the special power of the Holy Spirit that God longed to impart to them. The light that is to lighten the whole earth with His glory was resisted. And by the action of our brethren, has been in a great degree kept away from the world. You see, by quibbling and by jealousy and by open opposition, men and women believing in Jesus Christ and His soon coming have succeeded in delaying the return of Christ for over 100 years. That's the reality. The same ones who raised their hands back then and said, "I believe Jesus is coming soon," have succeeded by their actions in delaying the coming of Christ for 100 years. Letter 51A, 1895. God has given Brother Jones and Brother Wagoner a message for the people. When you reject the message borne by these men, you reject Christ, the giver of the message. Manuscript 5, 1889. Every fiber of my heart said, Amen. During those presentations at Minneapolis, eyewitnesses tell us that Ellen White would sit on the front row and was heard to say over and over, Amen, Amen. There is much light here. On one occasion, she even said that Dr. Wagoner was able to present righteousness by faith in a way that she herself could not. Now, in recent years, there has been a major attempt to prove that while some of the leading brethren rejected the message in 1888, most of them accepted it. And even the opposers later repented and came into line. As a result, we have been told our church eventually accepted the 1888 message, and we have been teaching it ever since. Don't you believe it for a moment. First, if we had accepted it, we would have been in the kingdom long before now. We wouldn't be preaching here in 1987. Our presence on this earth shows that there's still a problem. Second, the historical evidence itself shows a continued rejection of the message year after year after year. I will even go a step farther. I don't believe we have understood, believed, taught, or lived the 1888 message from that time to this time, 1987. We have either been trapped in legalism or in the new theology of unrighteousness by presumption. In 1926, Elder A.G. Daniels, a former General Conference president, wrote this: "The message has never been received, nor proclaimed, nor given free course as it should have been, in order to convey to the church the measureless blessings that were wrapped within it." In 1898, Ellen White was still speaking of stubborn defiance, of disunion, rejection of light. In 1902, she said, "I have been instructed that the terrible experience at the Minneapolis conference is one of the saddest chapters in the history of the believers in present truth." Willie White, her son, wrote, "The most serious feature of the disaffection was the fact that because Sister White urged the importance of the message of righteousness by faith, and because thereby she seemed to be upholding these brethren, Wagoner and Jones, contrary to their judgment, some of the leaders, it grew into a spirit of rejection of the testimonies of Sister White." A.V. Olson, 13 Years of Crisis, page 332. Do we wonder why we've had such a negative reaction to Ellen G. White during the last 10 years or so? All we are doing is reaping the fruit of the seed sown many years ago. Perhaps the heart of the whole problem is found in these comments by Ellen White in 1901. "Enough has been said over and over and over again, but it does not make any difference. They go right on just the same, professedly accepting it, but they do not make any change." Professedly accepting, but making no changes will never finish God's work even in 1,000 years. Could this be what has confused certain of our historians into assuming that lip service meant heart acceptance? Could the same thing be our problem today? Inspiration tells us that the leaders of the 1901 General Conference, quote, closed and bolted the door against the Spirit's entrance. The doors were barred against the heavenly current that would have swept away all evil. The result, now this is 1903, the result of the last General Conference has been the greatest, the most terrible sorrow of my life. No change was made. Now, if it is really true that God was going to finish his work on earth through this 1888 message, and if it is true that we have never really heard that message since that time, with isolated exceptions, and one of these is sitting on the platform with me, brothers and sisters, what is the message? What is that message that could have produced the latter rain and the loud cry then? And what is the message that will produce it if we accept it today? You know something? The message can be summed up in one Bible verse. Christ in you, the hope of glory. The 1888 message was focused on preparing God's people for translation. Thus, it had much to say about how to be perfect in Christ and thus ready for the close of probation. The message was not about personal assurance of salvation, but about vindicating and glorifying God's name. As we finish today, I'm going to share with you some excerpts, just a few, from the preaching of these men. And you decide for yourselves if you have heard this kind of preaching in the last 10 or 20 years. Christ took upon himself the flesh, not of a sinless being, but of sinful man. That is, that the flesh which he assumed had all the weaknesses and sinful tendencies to which fallen human nature is subject. In all of our Christian experiences, we have left little loopholes along here and there for sin. We have never dared to come to that place where we would believe that the Christian life would be a sinless life. We have not dared to believe it or preach it. But in that case, we cannot preach the law of God fully. Why not? Because we do not understand the power of justification by faith. And by the way, here's the difference between justification as taught by the evangelicals and justification in 1888. Only in the 1888 message do we hear about power to keep from sinning. And this victory is always linked with the fallen nature of our Lord and Savior. A few more quotes. Christ is to be in us, just as God was in him. And his character is to be in us, just as God was in him. It is the cooperation of the divine and the human, the mystery of God in you and me. That is the third angel's message. In Jesus Christ, as he was in sinful flesh, God has demonstrated before the universe that he can so take possession of sinful flesh as to manifest his own presence, his own power, and his glory instead of sin manifesting itself. Then God will so take us and so use us that our sinful selves shall not appear to influence or affect anybody. But God will manifest his righteous self, his glory before men, in spite of all ourselves and our sinlessness. And that is the mystery of God. Christ in you, the hope of glory. God manifest in sinful flesh. Now the flesh of Jesus Christ was our flesh, and in it was all that is in our flesh. All the tendencies to sin that are in our flesh were in his flesh, drawing upon him to get him to consent to sin. Perfection. Perfection of character is the Christian goal. Perfection attained in human flesh in this world. Christ attained it in human flesh in this world, and thus made and consecrated a way by which in him every believer can attain it. But before probation ends, there will be a people so complete in him that in spite of their sinful flesh, they will live sinless lives. They will live sinless lives in mortal flesh because he who has demonstrated that he has power over all flesh lives in them. lives a sinless life in sinful flesh. Do you see why I said that this is a rare message today? Instead of studying and learning how to live this message, we have become very divided on whether Christ even took our nature at all. And we are pretty sure that to discuss the word perfection is dangerous, that the word itself is a bad word, and sinless living is surely a fanatical extreme. Satan has done such a masterful job of closing our minds to the only message that can prepare us for the second coming of Christ. But brothers and sisters, he hasn't done his job well enough. He has not. In spite of his best efforts to destroy this message, to rub it into the ground, it is alive and it is well. Amen. And more people are waking up to its importance today. Amen. May I leave with you my personal conviction. I believe that God's people will not let this opportunity pass them by this time. I see an awakening among church members in this Seventh-day Adventist church, and I don't think Satan will be able to put them back to sleep again. But mark one thing very carefully. This awakening is happening among a small minority of church members. The majority continues to sleep on in a death sleep, assuming that as long as they keep coming to church, they are safe. What a tragic awakening it will be when too late, most Seventh-day Adventists will realize that they have the mark of the beast. If you want to avoid this tragedy, and if you want to see Christ return to this earth very soon, then I plead with you to reorder your lives if necessary, to make the study of this 1888 message your top priority, and to spend more time in study and prayer than you have ever done in your lives. Amen. Listen to God's final appeal to us through his mouthpiece, Ellen White. Light is flashing from the throne of God. And what is this for? It is that a people may be prepared to stand in the day of God. You who have devoted time and money to the adornment of your apparel and to the decoration of your homes, I would ask you, is Christ formed within you the hope of glory? It's too late in the day to be taken up with the frivolous things of the world, too late for any superficial work to be done. It is too late in the day to cry out against men for manifesting too much earnestness in the service of God, to say, you are excited, you are too intense, too positive. It is too late.